Researchers at Fermilab have just declared the results of the Muon g-2 experiment. But why are physicists around the world amazed at it? And what's all this fuss about new physics? Let us have a look into the experiment and what the results might signify. Twenty years ago, the experimental measurements of the Muon G factor at Brookhaven National Lab did not agree with the theoretical calculation. That's not because the theory is just wrong. Rather, it tells us that the calculations have missed something. And that something may be the physics beyond the standard model. The standard model of particle physics describes the elementary building blocks of nature with stunning accuracy. At some level, it is right in a very fundamental way. But it's not the whole picture, because it does not explain gravity. In fact, it does not fit properly with Einstein's entire theory of gravity, which itself is clearly right in its own. I have made a video on standard model in detail. You can watch it for better understanding. Standard model is one of the most verified theories of particle physics. Despite having some discrepancies, standard model is bound pretty tight to find a hole. But there is one hole that can be used. That is the anomalous magnetic dipole moment of the muon. Now let us discuss what is meant by an anomalous magnetic dipole moment and what is G in g-2 experiment. We are going to start by quantum spin. Every particle with electric charge also has quantum spin, which is not the same thing as simple rotation. The particles with quantum spin do generate a magnetic field, which is same as an electric charge moving around a looped wire or the electrical currents in Earth's spinning core. The result in all cases is a dipole magnetic field with a north and a south pole. If we place an object with such a field inside a second magnetic field, the object will tend to rotate to align with that field. The strength of that rotational pull or the torque is defined by the object's dipole moment. For a rotating charge, that depends on the object's angular momentum, charge, and mass. Here's the equation for the classical dipole moment for a non-quantum rotating charge. But to explain the intrinsic magnetic moments of electrons and many other elementary particles, we require a quantum mechanical treatment. It is these intrinsic magnetic moments that give rise to the macroscopic effects of magnetism. The intrinsic magnetic dipole is given by this equation, where μs is the Bohr magneton, s is electron spin, and g factor gs is 2 according to Dirac's theory. The factor of 2 implies that electron appears to be twice as effective in producing a magnetic moment as the corresponding classically charged body. The spin g factor 2 comes from the Dirac equation, which is a fundamental equation connecting the electron's spin with its electromagnetic properties. Reduction of Dirac's equation for an electron in a magnetic field to its non-relativistic limit yields the Schrodinger equation with a correction term. This correction term takes account of the interaction of the electron's intrinsic magnetic moment with the magnetic field and gives the correct energy. But in reality, value of G is slightly different from 2. To understand this phenomena, quantum electrodynamics might help us. In this theory, electromagnetic interactions result from charged particles communicating by exchanging virtual photons. We can figure out the strength of an interaction by counting up all the ways in which this interaction could occur. For example, a pair of electrons could repel each other by exchanging one virtual photon or two virtual photons or three, etc. Or those virtual photons could do something weird like momentarily becoming an electron-positron pair. We depict these interactions in Feynman diagrams. Each Feynman diagram represents one family of ways that the interaction could occur. And the sum of all possible Feynman diagrams gives the interaction strength. For a deeper understanding of Feynman diagrams, you can watch this video where I have discussed it in detail. The link is in the description. Now, we can represent an electron interacting with a magnetic field with the simplest possible Feynman diagram. We have an electron being deflected by a single photon from that field. If we calculate the G factor from just this simple case, we get a value of exactly 2. And as I said earlier, Paul Dirac also got G equal to 2 from his equation. But there are other ways this interaction could occur. The next simplest way is for the electron to emit a virtual photon just prior to absorbing the magnetic field photon and then reabsorbing the virtual photon. Same particles in and same particles out, but a slightly more complicated sequence of events. Adding this interaction allowed Julian Schwinger to calculate a slightly higher value of G, which is equal to 2.0011614. Over time, more and more complicated interactions were added. Each layer of complication involved many more Feynman diagrams, but it also added less and less to the interaction. The latest calculations rely on powerful computers to add many thousands of Feynman diagrams and get us our G factor to 12 significant figures. It matches experimental measurements to the accuracy of one part in a billion, which is by far the most accurate prediction in all of physics. So the g-2 in Fermilab's experiment name refers to the deviation of g from 2, and this difference is the anomalous magnetic dipole moment. Scientists thought if this worked so well for electrons, surely it should work for other particles too. But the reality is different. The electron is the lightest and most common of the lepton family. It has two heavier cousins, the muon and the tau particle. Muons are easily produced in radioactive decay, and they live only for a few microseconds, but that's long enough to work with them. During their brief existence, they are very similar to electrons. They have the same exact charge, and they interact with the same forces, and also have the same quantum spin. But they have a different G factor because there are slightly different ways that the muons can interact with the quantum fields. So we need to add up all the Feynman diagrams for all possible electromagnetic interactions of the muon. But we don't stop there. There are varieties of possible virtual particles in the quantum vacuum. There can be very subtle interactions that involve the other forces like weak, strong, and even the Higgs field. All of these change the muon's G factor by a tiny degree. If we include every possibility produced by the standard model of particle physics, we get a G factor that's slightly off the experimental results. So why are we getting the wrong value for the muon but not for the electron? Well, the physicists think that the reason behind this is muon's mass. The muon is 200 times more massive than the electron, and the probability of interaction between the particles and some massive virtual particle is proportional to its mass squared. So the muon is 40,000 times more likely to be perturbed. In this way, it's 40,000 times more likely than the electron to encounter, say, a virtual Higgs boson or a virtual proton or other hadron, and it's 40,000 times more likely to encounter any completely unknown virtual particles as well. But even if we account for all the known particles, we still get a G factor that is off. For this reason, the rising hope is that a yet unknown particle is at work here. So now it's time to explain the Fermilab Muon g-2 experiment. The Fermilab Muon g-2 experiment follows the same technique used at Brookhaven. Polarized muons whose spins are aligned with their direction of motion are injected into a 14.2 meter diameter storage ring. Here they circle thousands of times thanks to their relativistically stretched lifetime. As they decay, the muons spit out positrons that are detected by calorimeters lining the inner circumference of the ring. Inside the ring, the 1.45 Tesla magnetic field that keeps the muons traveling in a circle also provides the magnetic torque that causes spin precision. The muons interact with the magnetic field, and their own magnetic dipole axis rotate just like a spinning top does before falling. We call this as Larmor's precision, and its frequency depends on the G factor. If G were exactly 2, the precision period would be equal to the cyclotron period, and the muon spin direction would rotate in lockstep with the muon momentum vector. Instead, the spin direction gradually gets out of sync, taking about 27 turns before realigning with the momentum. This frequency difference is the anomalous precision omega A. Since the decay positrons are preferentially emitted in the direction of the muon spin, their spectrum shifts to the higher energies when the spin direction is aligned with the momentum. This shift produces a modulation in the number of positrons detected by the calorimeters. The anomaly can be written as the ratio of two frequencies, measured to high precision by the experiment. The first is the measurement of the anomalous precision omega A derived from analysis of the calorimeter response. The second is a measurement of the magnetic field along the muon's path derived from the precision frequency omega p of protons contained in a fixed and movable NMR probe. Deriving both frequencies requires extremely precise knowledge of the muon beam dynamics. Since each muon path samples a slightly different magnetic field and each calorimeter measures a positron modulation averaged over different muon orbits. The researchers obtained such information with extensive simulations with corrections for eddy currents and mechanical vibrations. Prior to this experiment, various labs over the past 20 years have refined the muon G factor measurement. Until now, it had been measured precisely enough to claim a 3.7 sigma difference compared to theory, and it was at Brookhaven National Lab in 2001. There's roughly 1 in 10,000 chance that random fluctuations could lead to that degree of difference. Physicists, however, prefer a 5 sigma signal before declaring a discovery. For 5 sigma, there's only 1 in 3.5 million chance of random noise resulting in the same signal. The Muon G-2 experiment at Fermilab hopes to push closer to this level of confidence and is designed to achieve 4 times the sensitivity of the Brookhaven experiment. But what is the sigma that I have been talking about? To be brief, they represent standard deviations. When scientists announce 3 sigma or 4 sigma or 5 sigma results, they are talking about the standard deviations from an expected value. The G-2 team announced that their latest result has 4.2 sigma confidence. So it is not yet a perfect detection, but definitely it means that we are on the right path. Fermilab's new results provide compelling evidence that the answer obtained at Brookhaven was not an artifact of some unexamined systematics, but a first glimpse of beyond standard model physics. While the results are based on the 2018's run, data taken in 2019 and 2020 are already under analysis. We can look forward to a series of high precision results involving both positive and negative muons, whose comparison will provide new insights on other fundamental questions, from CPT violation to Lorentz invariance. This future Muon G-2 campaign will lead to a fourfold improvement in the experimental accuracy, with the potential of achieving a 7 sigma significance of the standard model deficit. Thanks for watching. I hope you liked it. Please like and share this video. And to see such videos in future, do subscribe.